The next speaker is Professor Dinesh Singh. His speech is entitled Dealing with Change. He's Vice Chancellor of the University of Delhi, Director of the Mathematical Sciences Foundation in Delhi, and Adjunct Professor at the Department of Mathematics at the University of Houston. He's a member of various committees, I would say multiple committees, of the Government of India and of international agencies for furthering research and academic activities. He obtained his BSc and MSc in Maths from St. Stephen's College in Delhi and his Master of Philosophy from the same university. His PhD is from Imperial College, London, here. He's published many research papers in international and national journals, and his research has been widely cited in books and journals. Professor Singh.
I am delighted to be present here on this occasion and honored by this opportunity. This is in many ways a momentous occasion. The Association of Commonwealth Universities has served the cause of higher education for 100 years. And from what little I know of the history of the ACU, I don't think they have ever committed anything that could be termed a blunder. Looks like the course has always been steady upward movement. And this is a good opportunity for us to reaffirm our faith in the course and direction that the ACU will take for the next 100 years. And we could lay the foundation for such upward movement at this time. I do not claim to have any great wisdom, as any married man will know very soon after he gets married. And do not expect too much from me. But what I do have is some insight developed on the basis of my experiences and my interest in education. And I talk of change largely in the context of education. But of course, when you talk of education, you have to talk of the larger aspect of society that connects with it. Why talk of change? Why need change? You know, there's a saying in India. I'll quickly say that in Hindi, Neer dhalta bhala sadhu chalta bhala. Roughly translated, it says that water that keeps moving constantly is good, and ascetics should never stay at one place. They must keep moving, keep changing. Of course, we all know about water being oxygenated when it moves, so that's why flowing water is considered good, at least in those days when they didn't pollute rivers the way they do now. When it comes to ascetics, you will notice, I mean, I'll just make two mentions here. Jesus Christ, Mahatma Gandhi, they kept moving all the time. And it isn't just physical movement, but there is certainly, of course, something driving the whole thing, the nerve center of their thought processes. Of course, they were much more than ascetics, but the base level, they were ascetics, both of them. And that's important, this business of constant movement. Do universities respond to this requirement for change, given that we accept this as a matter of principle, an axiom, or philosophical truth? You know, there's a standing joke, and I'm sure many of you are familiar with this. How many professors does it take to change a light bulb? What? You're talking of change. That's the attitude. Faculty, university systems are very slow to respond to change. It's very, very difficult to get them to move. Partly, I hold society responsible for that. Society has, I must confess, do not get me wrong, I am the first to propound the belief that the essence of academics lies in its freedom. But you know, with freedom, there must be a certain degree of responsibility, awareness, and commitment towards the needs of society. That's what university systems are for. And that's where I believe that universities need to be constantly moving towards change. And I believe, you know, when we had the speakers here, Sir David and then Stephen, what they said makes me think of myself as the junior most judge on a multi-judge bench. We are required to pronounce sentence And when I heard both of them, as a junior most judge, my job becomes easy and all I have to say is I concur and judgment is pronounced. So there isn't too much for me to say. But once again, as I said, I just narrate some of my insights that come from my experiences. So what is the danger if we don't change? And I'll quickly highlight one danger. Just a few years ago, the world was faced with a huge economic crisis. And if you look at it, the nerve center of that crisis emanates from the west coast of the United States. There are two things I want to point out. I cannot think of any system in a collective fashion, a system, an institution, or a group of institutions that foresaw the need for changing the practices that were occurring in civil society related to financial systems in the US. I didn't see that. Not from the US, not from other institutions. You'll have occasional individuals making comments, sometimes half-hearted. But I just don't see institutions recognizing this. That is bad. That is unfortunate. The second point. If you look at the causes and what were the human resources behind that, they're coming from products of some of the finest institutions of the world. And I'm not running them down. Do not get me wrong. But there is something here that needs to be understood. That the products of the finest institutions collectively through institutional mechanisms get together to devise instruments that eventually lead to this great economic hardship for the whole world. Enormous hardship was caused, make no mistake. I just don't see any systems responding towards this. That's something we need to think of as university persons. We need to be careful about this. And the thing that Stephen mentioned, Sir David mentioned, and I think all of us believe in, this constant awareness towards the challenges of society. We must forever be doing that for a whole bunch of reasons. It isn't just one reason. The foremost reason is to capture and inspire the minds of the young. You know, we really need to look at that. If you can do that, nothing else would be really needed. Once you set the minds on fire, many things follow in a natural fashion in the wake of that. That is something we need to think about. Do institutions recognize this? But actually, I have much more to say. I believe that this concept of a university system needs a complete change. Of course, I'm not saying we do that immediately, but we must start recognizing that this change must be recognized, that the need for change must be recognized. That is something of utmost importance, necessity. And to do that, I'm also reminded, when I talk of change, of the well-known French saying, plus ça change, plus ça la même chose. The more things change, the more they are the same. And I now say that in the context of something that I've learned through my own little understanding of what has happened in India in the past. And I don't say this in any chauvinistic sense. So please do not misunderstand me. What I speak of is something with which I'm extremely familiar. This doesn't mean or doesn't preclude the possibility of the same insights, the same learnings having happened in many other parts of the world. All civilizations have their great value systems and they have developed essentially along similar lines. But I'm familiar with India. And India's traditions in the realm of knowledge generation, in the realm of education, are extremely ancient and very powerful. And we need to draw some quick lessons from there. In India, since time immemorial, so people cannot immediately date with accuracy some of our ancient texts. There are great debates. Some of them are dated to something like 3,000 years before Christ, some even beyond that. Certainly they are a few thousand years before Christ. And I pick on the Vedas. And I essentially pick the first of the Vedas, the Rig Veda. Again, I do not espouse any religion. I believe that all religions, and this is not a matter of political convenience, it's a sincere belief that they all say essentially the same thing, and the Vedas should not be looked upon as a religious text. I'm only talking of the philosophy there. The Rig Veda's opening stanza says, let noble thoughts come from every direction. I think this is something university systems must recognize first and foremost. And these thoughts, these stanzas, this poetry is not coming out of a university system. There's a point I'm trying to make, which I will at the end, why I said university systems need to change. Those who composed the Vedas were members of civil society who believed in the well-being of society. And they created a body of knowledge whose opening stanza says, let noble thoughts come from every direction. And then from the Vedas come these deep philosophical texts which are of practical use. The Upanishads, again, a few thousand years before Christ. And I cite from my favorite Upanishad, the Chandogya Upanishad, in which these are historical occurrences. There is this great teacher who runs a sort of university system, to whose school of knowledge comes a child of 12. In India, you went to a formal system, whatever it was, only at the age of 12, not before that. You were homeschooled. This child comes and seeks admission. And I was pleasantly surprised to learn systems haven't changed in some ways over all these millennia. Haridrumath, who runs this school, asks the child, what is your lineage? Only Brahmins are admitted. And the child says, I asked this question of my mother before I set forth for your school. The child's name is Satyakam Jabala. He says, my mother said, I have worked as a maid in many homes. Many men took advantage of me. I have no idea who your father is. I have named you Satyakam. My name is Jabala. Call yourself Satyakam Jabala. And Haridrumath responds immediately, I admit you, child, you are a Brahmin. There is only one way you recognize a Brahmin, this complete adherence to truth. You have spoken the truth, and that makes you a Brahmin. You are admitted. More importantly, Haridrumath recognizes something special in the child, and he responds accordingly. University systems must be like that. I want modern systems to understand this. Haridrumath does not tutor him in other ways that were traditional. He says, go forth to the forest with his 60 head of cattle, and do not return until they have multiplied so many fold. And this is called practical skills-based hands-on knowledge. The child returns after a certain period of time when they have multiplied. And Haridrumath then recognizes that the child has evolved. He has developed knowledge of a high quality. There's a point again, I will come back to that towards the end of my talk, but you must keep that in mind. But this wasn't just at the level of philosophy or practical education. Indian knowledge systems, and I talk of again much before the time of Christ, were well connected with the needs of society. Mathematics of an order in geometry, for instance, comparable to the best in Greek mathematics, to the best in Euclidean geometry, happened through direct needs of society in India a little before Greek geometry, a little before that. But it was all happening through the needs of society for practical purposes. Knowledge connected with practical purposes. I know mathematicians. I can cite historical records. I can cite texts that exist till today. But that's not the purpose. These are matters of history. However, the point is this, that Indian systems in mathematics, in physics, metallurgy, in medicine were based with the direct needs of society. And Indian society flourished. For hundreds of years before and after Christ, it's called the golden age of Indian society. And there were university systems that were supporting them. But they were connected. They were connected with the well-being of society. This morning I Googled, because I was curious to see, on Vasco da Gama, the great Portuguese explorer. And I looked at the BBC site, which tells, as of today, that Vasco da Gama was a great navigator who found the sea route to India. I checked with a Portuguese historian, a professor of history, just a few days ago, 2 or 3 months ago. And I learned first this fact from a Harvard historian, that Vasco da Gama picked up a navigator at the Cape of Good Hope from India. And that Indian ships were constantly traveling to the Cape of Good Hope for trade purposes and a little beyond regularly. Why could they do that, and why couldn't Europe do that? Simply because Indian systems, ships, were based on knowledge systems coming out of Indian institutions. What was the knowledge they were using? They knew how to navigate and find latitude at sea, which Europe did not know. The instrument they used was called the Rapalgai. The navigator that Vasco da Gama picked up was from Gujarat, a man called Kana. Why am I telling you this? And also European merchantmen who traveled by ships noticed that Indian ships were better built and they traveled faster because they were using nautical tables that came from the development of the calculus at least 400 to 500 years before the time of Newton from India. This is practical knowledge being used for the well-being of society. That is the learning I think somewhere we have missed. The point I'm trying to make is you must combine knowledge and skills. There is this tragic occurrence that has happened in systems of education all over the world, that skills have been looked at in some sort of inferior way, and knowledge seems to be something at the Brahmanical way in India. Unfortunate occurrence, because that wasn't the Brahmanical way. If you notice what Haridruma did with Satyakam. And you look carefully, Newton, one of the greatest minds the world has known, was an enormously skilled craftsperson. His insights into gravitation really come from his experiments with light. And all those experiments he crafted with his own hands. It isn't just Newton. You look at Michael Faraday, even Einstein, who worked on the shop floor of his father's factory, which ran an electromagnetic goods factory. And at one stage, Einstein felt like quitting his career in physics and helping out manage his father's factory. There were people who were connected with the use of their hands. And that has always been like that. You look at Mendel. I do not know how many of our students in university systems are aware. Of course, Mendel had those insights in genetics. But thousands of those pods, the plants, the pea plants, were planted by Mendel personally over a long period of time. You have to have the skill to actually nurture a plant. Generation after generation, thousands after thousands, when your insights develop. You look at Fourier, whose work, about half of 20th century mathematics by my estimation, and a great deal of physics and electrical engineering, and maybe other parts of knowledge, are based directly on the work of Fourier. And Fourier used his hands to gain insights. Then comes high-end knowledge. There has to be this thing. We need to connect. If you look at Craig Venter, he's not in any university system. He just works on his own. But he's an enormously skilled craftsperson. You must understand that. This business of skills, the use of hands, somewhere we have forgotten. And remember this, it isn't just about science. One of the greatest spiritual poets, poet who wrote great spiritual poetry, but if you leave aside the asceticism, the spiritualism, just look at his poetry in India. It is of a high order, a man called Kabir. He was illiterate, a weaver, but he used to weave. And there is a direct connection between those who weave and the kind of poetry they generate and the music they generate. I have observed it time and again in the Native Americans of Canada. I've noticed it in weavers in Andhra Pradesh. And Kabir, of course, is an outstanding example. This business of the use of hands, Mahatma Gandhi, who never said anything about anything until he had experimented and learned. And in education, he was well qualified to say that because he first ran a school personally. Then he set up a university in India, which runs till today. And he did other things. Said, in education, what you do with your hands enters your heart. What have we done? We have tried to remove these things and make our education more formal, a little removed, more abstract. We need to correct that. But is this model going to work? And how do we bring in society? First, as Stephen said, as Sir David said, and so many others of like you here, I'm sure, are aware, the challenges of society, you have to get young minds to engage with ferment. When there is a certain degree of ferment and there are challenges, then the youth get inspired. The university system must somehow connect youth with the challenges of society and bring that to some sort of direction. And here's where I share my experience with you, what we're trying to do at the University of Delhi. We've had a huge battle. As I said, getting faculty to talk of changing light bulbs is itself a huge task, let alone getting a system to move. And for those of you who are not convinced about what this struggle is, I can in private show you the scars on my back. Oh, I can see there are many with scars here. But let me sort of get back on track here. So what are we trying to do? We're trying to move a little bit towards a system that breaks down, as Stephen said, these barriers between society and knowledge systems. A university system is devised first and foremost, according to me, to recognize knowledge systems in all segments of society. Craig Venter, as I said, is in no system. Mahatma Gandhi never studied at a university. I do not know which university Jesus or the Buddha went. I cannot know of any such university. Let's recognize that knowledge systems exist outside these formal walls. For that, we need to break the walls in literal sense and otherwise. And how do we do that? So here's what we need to do. My belief is that we need to engage our youth, as I said, with challenges of society and give them some skills, analytical skills. I'm sure you know that. Quantitative skills, IT skills, communication skills, essentially that. And then let them find their way. So university systems must give that flexibility and freedom. But these must come from challenges of society, which can change with time. So systems need to be swift and fast, and they must move. How do we do that? So we changed in many ways. I'll give you a simple example. I launched a program called Bachelor of Technology Humanities. I deliberately coined it that way, technology and humanities. And I had huge opposition. It's called Design Your Degree. There is really nothing there. You decide. Today I need this, tomorrow I may need something else. But more than half your experiences in learning are based outside our classroom systems. They are connected with society. And it is bringing great results already. A bunch of students traveled to a village in India where they understood that the village had devised its own water supply system for running water. Villages in India generally don't have that. They used and taught themselves some mathematics, some simulation, and used good programming to devise a system that is essentially a model that can be fitted into other systems. Knowledge has come from this, and they have taught themselves things. I brought in some extraordinarily gifted scientists who are very good with their hands. And students who wanted to specialize in some sort of history-related program were the ones who were the most interested in what this gentleman had to say and are now taking a course with him. Well, the point I'm trying to make is we also run a whole train as a university, as a college. It just moves and acquaints itself with the challenges of society in India, and students try and look at them through projects. The point is this. Eventually, I believe that a classroom should melt from this today's notion into anything. It could be a Starbucks coffee shop. It could be a home. It could be any gathering, or it could be people seated wherever they are and connected. And to that end, India, I think, is making a fairly good beginning. The government of India has set up the National Knowledge Network. It's a high bandwidth, high-speed internet superhighway that has connected a huge number of educational institutions in India and is now reaching villages and towns. And knowledge is being brought in and sent back. It's the way the railways worked in India. They connected tracks and then they sent goods and passenger trains, and it did wonderful things for India in exactly the same way I believe this will. And we need to move from this traditional model and recognize that there is knowledge everywhere in society. University systems should learn to recognize that, certify that, and let students come through that and take graduation degrees. I believe that is the way of the future. Let me just end by telling you that in my system, in addition to whatever changes I brought about, there's a traditional open learning system that runs in a very primitive way. There are far more students enrolled in the traditional primitive system of open learning. It's the numbers that make up the revenues, and the revenues from that system are far more than what I get from all the other traditional systems that I have in place. The need of the future is these open learning systems. The challenge is to be flexible and make them open in the true sense, the way Haridrumath thought in the Upanishad. Thank you very much. So, you know, I actually spoke this morning on change and how universities need to be very quick with their feet when it comes to dealing with the needs of society, and for which they must be ready for change. So the one core message that I would like to give through my talk as the idea of a university must change radically, and it can take lessons from the past, especially in the Indian context. There are enough examples to illustrate. And we must be connected, so there must be a seamlessness between society and institutions of learning. And that can only happen when literally and metaphorically we break our walls. That was the whole message. I believe that universities have been given a certain degree of, you know, leeway, which somehow seems to hold them back from changing quickly enough. And this is a worldwide phenomenon. But the one thing I recognize is that universities are recognizing that they need to change. I can see that in the air. So let me give you an example. You know, a university system must be able to give direction to society and sustenance as well. Now, you could look at many things, but I'll give you one or two simple illustrations. You know, in India, we have a bit of a problem with tuberculosis, the disease. TB is in reasonably, you know, it's more than endemic, but not an epidemic or anything. And there has not been a really good test for detecting tuberculosis that could be called reliable. Some colleagues of my university who work in molecular biology got into the act, and it seems all results indicate that they've developed a test which is inexpensive, very reliable, and very quick, and it's based on molecular biology. So here's high-end knowledge with some immediate practical application, and I believe it'll do India a great deal of good. So that's just a modest example, but that's the way university systems need to go and make difference to society. So if you notice what I said in my talk, generally universities should and do work in several ways that do benefit society, but in many ways they seem to be quite removed. And let me just look at the models that exist in many parts of the West. They seem to be first and foremost pricing themselves out of the market. You know, get university education is becoming an expensive proposition in many parts of the West. Not everywhere. There are countries that do a lot to provide access to education, but there are big and large institutions which are not doing that. That, I believe, is harmful. Harmful for the university, harmful for the country, harmful for things at large. But I think they are recognizing that as well. I don't exactly know what the post-2015 agenda is, but let me tell you something. Whatever is in the future is certainly very important for us, because the world is changing very rapidly. If you glean from the few talks that have already happened today here at this gathering, you can see that the world is changing very rapidly. China is setting up factories in Africa. No one could have thought of this 5 years ago. What are the sociological implications of this? What are the economic implications of this? What are the technological implications of this for Africa, for China? It's a job of universities to look at that and to give direction. Maybe Africa doesn't want that, or it should not have it, or maybe it should have it. But that cannot be understood or answered until university systems do that. This is happening at more and more rapid pace, and is going to keep happening in the future. University systems need to get this on the agenda. You know, in this short time that I have been here at this event, I deem it an important event for the following simple reason. That in this short time, I have picked up and learned and have sort of become curious about so many things happening in different parts of the world. And hopefully, my wife notwithstanding, I will go back a wiser man.